Thank you, Jack, for that kind introduction, and good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
So I know the questions that must be in your mind are, well, at what level of manganese do we have to monitor, do we have to report, and take corrective action? So I'm going to cover that today, some of those basic questions, and I'm going to start with a historical perspective on manganese. How many of you are familiar with the 0.05 milligrams per liter? Yes. Standard. I call it the aesthetic standard. When your sampling results exceed 0.05, as Rich was saying, that's when some of those aesthetic issues come in. That's when the consumer complaints might be coming up. And up to now, MassDEP hasn't had a lot of requirements if you exceed 0.05 milligrams per liter. Only in the case that there are a lot of consumer complaints where you might have been asked as a public water supply to take corrective action. That's changed as of 2014. To start with, you know, where everyone knows that if you exceed 0.05 milligrams per liter in your sample results, you might be getting some complaints on the taste, the color, the staining of laundry or plumbing fixtures. And the US EPA, you know, has set a secondary maximum contaminant level of 0.05 because of this reason. Before 2014, it was just voluntary. Our letters would go out and say voluntary monitoring, you know, or if you get a lot of complaints, then we might get into asking you to do some type of corrective action. Manganese is in food with no apparent side effects. And manganese is in water naturally in small concentrations, so it's not an issue. That's what we historically have thought. Another thing, which was an operating assumption of the past, is that, well, if people saw that their water looked dirty or was discolored, maybe they wouldn't drink it. So there couldn't be any health effects, and we found that that's not the case either. There was a need to look at the health effects of manganese, especially as the research was showing that, that there were more and more health effects with higher concentrations of manganese. It can be toxic in sufficiently high doses and produce neurological effects. And especially infants are most susceptible. And this is because infants haven't developed the capacity to excrete excess ingested manganese. So why we're mentioning infants is when you see some of our guidelines coming up, we highlight the infant population. We highlight daycares. If we have anyone here representing a daycare facility, a daycare public water supply, probably not today, but we'll be talking about that. There are acute exposure health effects associated with manganese in drinking water. Infants can have acute health effects at levels greater than 0.3 milligrams per liter. And for this reason, US EPA issued a health advisory, which is 0.3. And then MassDEP, with Office of Research and Standard, followed EPA and also set the ORSG as 0.3 and another guideline health advisory at 1.0. milligram per liter. So there are reporting and monitoring requirements that if it's greater than 0.3 up until 0.1, and then if it's greater than 1 up to 1, and if it's greater than 1, then we'll talk about that too. But in terms of the acute exposure health effects, besides infants having acute health effects, if the levels are greater than 0.3, which is why there's a guidance here, the general population can have acute health effects at levels greater than 1.0. milligram per liter. And then there are chronic exposure health effects. Adults over a lifetime may experience chronic health effects with levels over 0.3 milligrams per liter. So the MassDEP, Office of Research and Standards, set the ORSG based on three target populations, right? There's the general population and the infant population. To start with the general population, again, for a lifetime exposure, it's recommended that the level that's in the drinking water is not exceeding 0.3 milligrams per liter. And for the general population, if your sample results are showing manganese greater than one, and that it's happening in Massachusetts, not as commonly, but it is happening in some public water supplies. It's recommended that the general population doesn't drink the water more than a 10-day exposure. And for infants less than 1 year of age, it's recommended that they are not exposed to drinking water with greater than 0.3 milligrams per liter any more than 10 days. So basically less than 10 days is the recommendation for exposure. Some of the language that's contained in the public notice is a reference to infants ingesting this water, and that perhaps alternative water, such bottled or treated water, be used for infants, and that's what it says here. But that's language that's in the standard public notice, that if you had to issue a public notice, that would be in there. In many cases, it is. So how are the DEP health advisories set? It's quite a detailed process. The health advisories are based on, first, the adequate dietary manganese intake levels that are known to be fine without adverse health effects. But then, as a precautionary measure, these health advisory guidelines are set, and the general population is considered, is asked to consider limiting their consumption of drinking water if it levels higher than the ORSG guideline health advisory, such as greater than 0.3 or greater than 1 milligram per liter. And that infants under the age of 1 shouldn't be given water over the health advisory, over the ORSG, right? So that's a brief discussion of the health effects. There is a lot more information on the MassDEP website. If you're interested in seeing some of the research studies, there are studies from all over the world, actually, regarding drinking water and manganese, and you're welcome to look at that. I'd like to review just briefly what's happened over the past year or so with the manganese program, because it was only just about a year ago, a little over a year ago, that the first letters went out. It was actually late in 2013, I think it was October. All your public water supplies were notified, all the public water supplies in Massachusetts were notified that there was going to be some new requirements for monitoring and reporting for manganese, and introducing this to you. And then in 2014, baseline finished water sampling was required from all public water supplies. So we know the starting point, wherever it was starting. And I'm going to talk about in a moment what happened when those baseline sample results showed that some public water supplies were over 0.3 or over 1 or over 0.05 in some cases, because that changed the monitoring requirements too. And in the 2014 to 2016 sampling schedules have been revised in some cases because of these baseline results. Okay, baseline results changed your monitoring requirements, and some of you, if you're in that situation, you had or have been sent some revised schedules for sampling. In 2014, most public water suppliers in Massachusetts did submit baseline results. Because it's a fairly new program, we sent out forbearance letters, which allowed a 30-day extension to the sampling requirement in 2014. And as I said, most public water suppliers have submitted the baseline sampling results. In 2015, MassDEP will move forward with a compliance and enforcement process for the drinking water program, for the manganese program in drinking water. This is not new or different for MassDEP. It's something that's done across the board with all MassDEP programs. And the type of notices that will be sent will include something called a notice of non-compliance, something you probably don't want to receive, but that's what it's called initially. And it would be for failure to sample or failure to public notice. And you'll be hearing about public notice in a minute. Or failure to take a corrective action. And those requirements are going to be really clearly explained to you, because I'll explain briefly, and maybe our regional person will also explain this too. When you submit sampling results to MassDEP and you trigger one of these health advisories, or trigger the 0.05 acidic standard, then there's a process that goes into place. There's a letter that's sent by the regional office that says you have exceeded this, this is what you need to do. I mean, all the requirements, the public notice, to sample, to monitor, to do a corrective action plan, it's all in the letter. So it's not as if you have to guess, but it's nice that you're here today because you know, at least you know what's happening in advance, so you can prepare for it. You don't even have to wait for the letter. You could call the region and have a discussion about it before the letter goes out. Starting in 2014, baseline finished water monitoring samples were required. And that's finished water versus raw water. And we have had some confusion in that area. There have been some raw water samples submitted to us from systems that were treating for other contaminants. So, you know, we want to see it. So we really want the finished water sample. If the monitoring results that you come up with in your baseline data from 2014 are in future sampling that you do are greater than 0.3 milligrams per liter, then these are the actions. First step is to take a confirmatory sample within 2 weeks, and that's for all public water supplies. But right up front, everyone takes a confirmatory sample within 2 weeks. And if the average is greater than 0.3, then there are a series of actions to take. Here's an example, public water supply. They exceeded 0.05, and they went on quarterly monitoring. And during that, before we even reached four quarters, in the second quarter, they exceeded 0.3. So, well, they knew they needed to take a confirmatory sample, and they did, and they still exceed 0.3. So what kind of monitoring they're on? They're still on monitoring, quarterly monitoring. So you're going to continue quarterly monitoring and report it to MassDEP to go into the other requirements, such as public notice, et cetera, but you're continuing quarterly monitoring in the meantime. For all systems, at least we know that if the average is over 0.3, there are going to be some actions, and the actions are going to vary whether you're a TNC, NTNC. We're going to get to that now. First, community public water supplies, and the other ones are coming up. All right. Community public water supplies. So exceeding 0.3, you've confirmed it. The average, you've confirmed it. It's over 0.3. You've notified the regional office, and you're going to get a letter from the regional office that says, okay, do public notice, do tier 2 quarterly public notice. This is consistent for all drinking water contaminants. It's something you've heard before. It's not different. All tier 2 public notice requirements are the same, depending on, no matter what contaminant it is. So it's the standard process, public notice process. There's an actual notice you notify your public with, or there's an exception. If your public water supply has already issued in your consumer confidence report in the previous year, language in it that talks about the health effects and of manganese, and that you've triggered the health advisory, the ORSG. If you've already issued that information to the general population in the prior year, then you don't need to do a public notice again. Okay. Now, I'm assuming all of you are familiar with the consumer confidence reports. Every year, you issue them to MassDEP. In addition, if a community public water supply exceeds the 0.3 milligrams per liter, in your current year consumer confidence report, there has to be a notice. And the language of that notice, we have it all written out for you. We can give you a template of what you put in there. So it's not, you don't have to create the language in it. We have templates to make it easy for you. And that information is usually, I understand, sent to you in that letter that the region sends. There is a quarterly monitoring requirement, which will continue. Someone kind of asked for a different kind of system, but say in this case, okay, how long do you quarterly monitor? You continue quarterly monitoring until the level is less than 0.2 milligrams per liter. And you're asked to produce a corrective action plan, a long-term corrective action plan. There are many different types of actions that you can take. Source management, you know, taking the source offline. It could be adjusting treatment that's already in your system for the benefit of removing manganese. Some of the current treatment that systems are using are finding if they adjust it a little is actually lowering the manganese level. So there are many different ways you can have a corrective action, including treatment. And so you're asked to produce a plan, submit it to the regional office for review. And if you're a community public water system, and once you've done the initial public notices, and the public notices go to chief elected officials, and they go to the general population and all that, you can get a waiver. You can apply for a waiver to do future public notice, but there is going to be a fairly new waiver process. If your manganese exceeds 0.3, it's a different language that you put in the consumer confidence report. And this is the text that you'll be provided and the information MassDEP gives you, that this text needs to be in there, that drinking water may naturally have manganese, et cetera, et cetera. But this is what's been found in our public water supply water. So what if you're a non-transient, non-community public water supply, such as a school, and if your level's over 0.3? There are the same Tier 2 public notice requirements. Posting of the public notice for your consumers, you know, posting it up so it's visible. A letter to the workers, and that's depending on a case-by-case basis that may be needed, you know, to notify because the workers are drinking the water. Quarterly monitoring and a corrective action plan. And now there are two types of transient non-community public water supply systems. There are those with daycares and without daycares, such as restaurants, gas stations, campgrounds. First, I want to talk about transient with daycares. If the manganese in the drinking water is 0.3 milligrams per liter or more, the Tier 2 public notice, same thing. Posting of the public notice for the consumers. A letter to the workers, depending on the case-by-case basis, quarterly monitoring, and corrective action plan, which is very similar to the previous one. Now, for transient systems without daycares, say restaurants, gas stations, campgrounds, or where the people are transient, just quarterly monitoring is required until the level is greater than 0.3 up until 0.1. And if the level is greater than 1 in transient non-communities without daycares, and again, we're mentioning daycares because of the infant concern. Okay, it's one of the most susceptible populations, so they're in a different category. But if these are transient non-communities without daycares, such as restaurants, gas stations, and campgrounds, there's a Tier 2 public notice, posting of the public notice for consumers, the letter to workers on a case-by-case basis, and quarterly monitoring. So to review, you've done your monitoring for manganese, and you look at your results, and it's 0.02, under 0.05. Does anything have to be done? Well, at that point, you want to contact your regional office, because it's under the 0.05 SMCL. They will tell you what the frequency of monitoring will be required. And if it's 0.05 or more, is there additional action? As of 2014, yeah. See, before, there wasn't, but as of 2014, there is. And that's the quarterly monitoring for 4 consecutive quarters until you average less than 0.2 milligrams per liter. If the level exceeded 0.3 milligrams per liter, is there additional action? Yes. And what that action is now, it's going to be dependent what kind of system you are. Community, non-community, non-transient, non-community, transient, non-community. If you have any questions, call us. Let us know. We'll help you out. And if the level is greater than 1.0, the requirements can vary. And yes. So for more information, the first contact for you would be your regional contact person. My contact information and Margaret Finn, who also works in Boston, her information is also here. Thank you.